amazing, the new jungler. Mid lane is Kaltard, forgiven as the AD carry, and of course, Unlimited as the support.
And on the red side for this matchup, it will be Alliance. Wicked up top, Shook in the jungle with Froggen in the mid lane, and of course, Tabs and Nif as your AD carry and support.
And of course, the featured matchup for this game is going to be Amazing vs. Shook. They are two junglers of the highest quality, and Amazing, well, he was brought in to replace Shook just in the middle of October.
Yeah, very, very recently, and part of the reason we've highlighted this is that Alliance, let's be frank, they took Shook from Copenhagen Wolves, and we're going to start with Amazing. He's playing to his namesake. A 5.72 average KDA over the last two events, that includes IAM Cologne and the promotional tournament, and the online component, averaging a 6 KDA. It is absolutely brilliant, and we're expecting Amazing to lead from the front for the Copenhagen Wolves.
And I hate to bring it up because I know the man is watching, but Crumbs came up against Shook and they got destroyed in the jungle because he performed well. You know, we were talking about it before the game. It's like, will he live up to his hype? Well, he damn well did. And honestly, players like Diamond, Aranair, they're all expecting him to continue on performing well.
One of the things I also want to highlight about this player is he's actually reformed. As we said, he was not allowed to play in the LCS last year in 2013. He's come back. He's a positive influence now. Teams are able to pick up play with him. And like you said, he's highly rated by every single professional player we've spoken to. He has the stats to back it up. And the one thing that we've talked about is his natural synergy with Froggen. It's just something that happened. When Froggen started looking for players, he approached Shook. They started playing with all different mixtures. I mean, this is the 7th, 8th, 9th, 10th iteration of the super team, right? But the case remains that him and Shook were at the core. They destroyed every time they played. Froggen even said in one of his videos, it's easy to get kills when you land your skill shots, and Shook doesn't miss his skill shots.
Absolutely. So, we're going to get in towards Champion Select. Let's get this game underway, ladies and gentlemen. Game 2 of the European LCS, the 2014 Spring Split. Picks and bans starting off immediately. Lee Sin banned away from Shook.
Elise is something I'm expecting to feature, if not a ban, as a very high priority for a pick. I think Amazing and Shook like to play Elise, so I'm anticipating seeing that come through. And then, of course, the usual support bans. The Annie, Leona, Thresh also would not surprise me when you consider the caliber of Unlimited as well as Nif.
Yeah, Kassadin is almost a given these days. He's going to get banned out regardless. Annie also taken away. Just saw that how well that worked out for Yellowstone in the last match, so no surprise there. Kha'Zix being taken away. Don't want to let Kaltard on that. Kaltard, he's had a number of champions. He's actually a player that's played in the LCS before. He was here with the Copenhagen Wolves before in their first iteration, of course, with Newcaster Deficio, who you'll be seeing later on, but he's going to know all about that one. But as it is, Yasuo once again banned out. No surprises here. This is a champion that's been so strong coming into this.
I'm really expecting Yasuo to be 100% banned this, at least on day one. I don't think anyone's going to let him slide through. The one thing I do want to talk about in the mid lane, though, is a few more champions are available. Riven is still there if we want to see them being picked. Froggen has confided in me his secret counter to a Ziggs pick. And I don't want to reveal it because, again, it is something in confidence, but if we do see Ziggs being locked in, it is something that Froggen has prepared something special for in reply.
Well, it's been banned out, so that's already been removed. And it does mean that Elise does get through and was instantly first pick there. So I expect that's going to be for Amazing.
Definitely. There's almost no doubt in my mind. That is as important as getting it for Amazing, who likes to play early ganking junglers, as much as it is denying it from Shook. Shook played Elise against Dignitas, and it was terrifying. He managed to pick up First Blood in actually both of the maps, if memory serves, in the mid lane with Froggen against Skara in the very first game on the big stage. So a nice pickup there for the Copenhagen Wolves.
Well, we talked about how the 2014 patch is working out, certainly the 3.15 for the tanky meta. And, well, Wicked is a player that knows how to play those tanky champions. Renekton being locked in there, and Caitlyn for Tabs, a champion we saw constantly on Tabs throughout the summer.
Yeah, very comfortable pick here for Wicked. It is a tank he's played many, many times. It fits in the meta. I maybe would have preferred to have seen a Shyvana. I think it would have been stronger, but knowing Wicked, he's a little bit stubborn when it comes to his picks, so he's playing something he's comfortable with. The Caitlyn pick is also smart because it's a very long range. It's safe, you just sit on the outskirts, and as long as the rest of your team zones for you, you'll do well.
Well, there is the Lucian Shyvana. Froggen just toying with the crowd's hearts, I feel, because Anivia is being hovered over, but I don't feel it's going to get locked in. In fact, I don't expect to see a mid lane again locked in here at all.
I don't think so either. The fact that you have the counter pick available for you means that most likely you're going to move to another option. It does look like they're toying with a few others, but for Shook, an aggressive in-your-face jungler, somebody like a Vi, like a Xin Zhao, those types of champions, you know, Lee Sin's already been banned and Elise is taken away. Those would be the high priority picks that I'm expecting to see from him.
course, NIF being the new support on Alliance as well. Coming over, he played for SK Gaming throughout the promotion, helped them, honestly carried them, I would say. Really set up a lot of those ganks, but that was on Leona, if you remember rightly. So I'm not surprised we're not going to be heading towards that. Instead, he's looking towards a Thresh, maybe.
I'm a little disappointed we haven't seen the Leona just yet. I think the Leona Vi synergy is so strong, because once Leona locks Vi locks a target down, Leona just makes it impossible for anybody else to help. Thresh can also work, but you need to make sure it's at the right place. There can't be minions, there can't be champions to block death sentence. But what Thresh does also give you in lane is a little bit more safety. You can set up those Lantern Vi ganks, which is very, very powerful, and I would expect to see that happen. Shook likes to roam, he likes to gank a lot.
Final two picks coming for Copenhagen Wolves. Who will the mid laner be? What will Froggen try to counter it with? That's what we're going to be seeing here. Of course, the other pick would be in the
support role.
Which I'm trying to think what options they're going to go with here. It could be a Lulu, could be a Sona as well. We've seen that coming out up against Threshers.
So the one thing I want to see from this mid laner now is we're most likely going to see like a pick like an Orianna. It would have to be a fairly safe pick. You don't necessarily want to run the risk of being hard countered. But the Lulu is something that I know DeFishu is actually very excited about. He's an avid Lulu player, and we talked about the changes in 3.15 and how Lulu's got some strengthening buffs is the words I'm looking for. And the very key power is whatever Vi dives onto, you can throw Wild Growth on. Gives him extra chance to survive. And it makes it very clear, hey, Alliance want to kill that guy, so you throw Intervention as well. I like the pick from Copenhagen Wolves. It's very reactionary and gives them strengths against what Alliance are looking to do.
I'm interested to see what Froggen is potentially countering this Kale. We've seen Kale being incredible in the Battle of the Atlantic. We saw it throughout the promotion as well, just absolutely blowing people up in that Battle of the Atlantic. That was Celebar, of course. Could it be Gragas? Kind of a standard pick as well for him, but it is a good counter. It does clear the waves so quickly.
That's one of the biggest things. Gragas' early game, pre-6, is going to make Kale's life very difficult. Kale needs some of those levels, gets that Righteous Fury and attack speed up to clear the waves. So Froggen should be able to grasp control of that lane if he locks in this Gragas. The one thing that is scary is that the more this Kale scales, the easier it's going to be to shut down Gragas and Caitlyn, who are actually pretty squishy champions overall. So there's a lot of pressure on Froggen, even more so that this is his team, to perform well and not get caught out by Kowtard's Kale.
So here we go. The teams are locked in. For the first time, the Copenhagen Wolves, as their current form, I should say, is not the first time, because they've been here before, of course, during the spring of 2013. Very different team, though.
Yeah.
Although, same mid laner before the second coming of Christ.
Never won a game in the LCS.
Managed to get into the game. But Alliance, it is a new lineup behind Froggen and Wicked. Will it work out for them? Are we seeing anything in the synergy of these two teams that would give them tip the edge?
I actually feel like both of these teams are very good. They've got very good engage potential. You've got Cocoons, you've got Shyvana that can dive in, that can, you know, throw a Wild Growth on top of an already tanky dragon form Shyvana. It's not as clear cut though as a Vi Assault and Battery. So I think Alliance have got a slight lead when it comes to the initiation, but both teams have got the ability to counter engage. Shyvana can use her ult defensively, Kale defensively, Lulu defensively. So you've got teams that can do both tricks well. And as long as Copenhagen Wolves don't get jumped on by Vi too much, it's going to come down to individual skill and team fights.
And with all that defensive work, I hope there's going to be some attacking, let's face it. But before we get the match underway, let's see who you guys at home think will be winning this one. Checking out the lollysports.com vote. 79% of you have voted for Alliance. I'm not too surprised by this one.
I don't think anybody's too surprised. I think Copenhagen Wolves, yes, they had a phenomenal amateur series and challenger series turnout throughout last year, but now this is their first really big exposure on the big stage. And for a lot of fans watching, this may be the first time they've ever seen the Wolves, so we'll have to see how they do against the European super team.
Well, here we go, ladies and gentlemen. We are about to get underway. Copenhagen Wolves up against Alliance. Game two of the European 2014 Spring Split. Who will make it through? That's the question. Alliance, of course, as their new team coming into this one, formerly Evil Geniuses, they split apart. We saw Snoopy, Crepo, and Yellowpete all heading off to the North American LCS, managing to get their way into there. Meanwhile, Copenhagen Wolves, of course, will be playing as the blue team. And no surprise, when there's a team that's got Froggen and Wicked involved, we get a pause.
Yeah, it's Froggen's fault. I'm just laying it down. Actually, no. It is NIF that has quickly disconnected, so we'll see how rapidly they can get themselves back into this game. But I think tension is very high, And I also expect this game to have a fairly slow start. saying that Gambit invaded it through 2.5 minutes and it backfired. But, you know, the early level one deep wards, it's something we haven't seen in a long time, and I'm not expecting to see it right now.
Yeah, we're just waiting for Niff to restart his game, which is what he's doing, which is where you can see a big grin on his face and a thumbs up as he seems happy with how things are working. So hopefully this game will get underway in a moment. Where do we see the strengths in these two teams? Where do we see it? Like early game, late game, mid game? Who's going to be aiming for what? Who's going to be going aggressive early on?
Well, Alliance definitely have an early to mid game power spike. Once Renekton, Vi, and Gragas hit around the level 10, level 11 point and start having that very high burst from Gragas as well as the initiation potential of Vi, I think that's when we're most likely going to see Alliance starting to roam and get those objectives, much like Fnatic did. Once the game starts going further and Kayle scales even more to that insta-gib potential, that's when I think Copenhagen Wolves can start to strike back. So the key for me is for Copenhagen Wolves not falling behind the sort of 12 to 25 minute mark.
And of course, let's not forget that Fnatic are going to be up against Alliance. They're going to be taking notes on this one. What do we make of game one between Fnatic and Gambit? Because that was a lot more one-sided than we were expected.
It caught me by surprise. I will not be afraid to say that I expect the Gambit to win that game based on what we've been seeing in the postseason. And I think Fnatic, you heard Pekka saying they prepared for it. They prepared for the individual matchup. And when they prepare for a matchup, they appear to play very well.
Well, if you want to check it out, if you missed it, get over to lollysports.com. It will be up and available on VOD very shortly. Meanwhile, we are into game two. Copenhagen Wolves is the blue team. You can see Kautard, his second return into the LCS. Let's see if it's a bit more successful, because unfortunately for him, he did not win a game the first time he was here. Of course, they are up against the All-Stars, almost the Alliance team. Will they be able to live up to the hype that has been created around this super team?
Well, this is their very first game in the LCS. They definitely delivered at the Battle of the Atlantic. And once again, as we're seeing, a very defensive posture from both of these teams, covering all the entrances to their jungles. We're seeing the trinkets, the war trinkets all the way down the lists. No sweeping lenses from either of the teams. The only one that was different in the previous game was, of course, Edward starting with that on his Thresh. And it doesn't look like any team is setting up either for a 2v1 or for an invade just yet. So we're going to see those head-to-head matchups.
Yeah, very static gameplay from these teams, and almost back into full-on Season 1 style of all standard play. We'll see whether Renekton is going to help out. Looks like he's going to be helping Shook out in the jungle. Winnet Kid will be coming down there, help out on that red buff. Of course, we're seeing Amazing and Kautard over at the blue buff. It is going to be Youngbuck helping him out on that blue, and the mid laners do return. So standard starts from both teams. Let's see who manages to create the first advantage.
At this point in time, I think that the early game poke that Lulu is going to offer, thanks to that little pick, so all the additional damage is going to help out, especially because the early game poke of that piercing light from Lucian is actually going to be superior to Caitlyn's Piltover Peacemaker. So early levels for Forgiven and Limited, we'll see if they can take advantage. They've got a decent CS lead, and they've force Tabs and Niff back.
Yeah, early trades seem to go heavily in favor of them, and Alliance force back already on towards their tower. We do see the first kill, CS going down for Tabs. He's had to use his heal pot already early on as well, so that's a bad start for the Alliance bottom lane. Meanwhile, at the top lane here, we do see Wicked and Youngbuck trading places, trying to just jump around from each other, but it is safe play in the early first few minutes.
Yeah, nothing too exciting right now, and I think, you know, the trades between both Youngbuck and Wicked is eventually going to work out in Wicked's favor. He's got an inherent ability to lifesteal back. He's got that Cull the Meek, so any poke that Youngbuck does manage to get down is not going to last as long as if it's, you know, on his own champion. As it stands right now, though, it's just a very, very slow start for these two teams. And advantage in the mid lane is sitting with Kautard, using Kayle's Righteous Fury and that sort of range poke to keep Froggen on the back foot.
Yeah, it's got a good CS advantage already building up here. You can see it's a 10 CS advantage almost in there already, but Froggen, of course, the CS master, picking up the 300 CS in 23 minutes on Karthus back in Season 2 World Finals. But right now, he's on Gragas, and he's being forced onto tower by Kautard.
Yeah, definitely, you know, on the back foot. We've seen those last couple barrels actually haven't given him any sort of CS advantages, and its early trades are actually going in favor of the Wolves here, with the exception of the top lane. And we'll have to see how Froggen bounces back from this. It is only 7 CS, which he'll make up for in this exact wave, thanks to a very early back by Kautard. And I like this decision to pick up Boots in the wards, because he knows Shook likes to gank. We talked about how he likes to help out Froggen, especially once Vi gets closer to 6. and those boots are going to allow him to avoid any damage from Gragas's barrels.
Well, speaking of early ganks, we do see at the top lane Amazing coming around the backside. It's meanwhile it's the bottom. We're looking around. Flash from there is going to miss out. Renekton having to go the opposite way around there. Wicked having to use that flash early on, so Amazing forcing out someone to spell out.
It's not over yet. Now Shook going to try and do a reply here onto Forgiven Unlimited, but his AD carry and support Tabs and Niff are low on HP, so they need to pick a perfect engage. Here comes Shook with his double buffs.
Niff's going in there, gets the flay on Unlimited. That's the target they need to go for, but he's already flashed away. Flash comes back out from Shook as well. The Ignite is burning. Is there going to be enough damage? Tries to pull in Tabs. Tabs is going to try for the Pilt over the shot.
He got
the 90 caliber net execution. Unbelievable.
Brilliant play. It's not over. It's now Wicked's in trouble.
Wicked's in trouble in the top lane. He is going to go down. Who will pick up that kill? It's going to be Youngbuck with the burnout.
Tabs was brilliant there. He first got pulled in by the Lantern, then used his incredibly high mechanical skill to land the very quick 90 caliber net plus Piltover Peacemaker. If you fire them quickly enough, they shoot at the same time from your original position while you back away. You do see now Froggen getting ready in this mid lane against Kautar, and he's gone in on Kal.
He's going in there. Kautar's second low. The Ignite's already been used out. Froggen, though, gets flashed away from that final barrel. That would have been the final hit. Shook coming in, not going to land the kill.
No, there's no flash here for Shook either, nor does he have his red buff, if I noticed that correctly. Kautar sticking around,
uh-oh,
and it looks like they're going in.
Looks like he's going in. Kautar should just be able to exit straight away stage right. He does have the help of Amazing also coming around that jungle.
Well, we'll see how Amazing sticks around. One of the best tower dives is Elise because, of course, you can just reset that aggro with the repel. Right now, there's a minion wave that's going to get melted thanks to Froggen's barrel, and I don't know if they really want to go for this dive. A lot of damage, and there's no intervention yet from Kautard. So until he gets his ultimate, I don't think it's the smartest of decisions.
Well, Amazing using a lot of time here. He's sticking around that wraith area. Finally, he is going to back away. Shook still in the vicinity, and now we're making his way back towards the mid lane. Meanwhile, we see Amazing. He's heading north. Another go at Wicked.
Well, we'll see. Froggen is about to get level 6, if I'm not mistaken. We do see the Cocoon could land here onto Wicked. If it does, they might go in. Not going to be the case. Good slice and dice usage from Wicked. Steps into the minion wave, slices once, and then dices to get the furthest distance back. Wicked just showing his experience. Even though he's a death down, he's still sitting on the same CS as Youngbuck.
And let's not forget that Youngbuck on the Shyvana will be down at the bottom. Meanwhile, down the bottom lane, we're seeing a bit of an exchange coming out there. The shield being thrown out. Unlimited actually doing a good trade with Tabs there. Tabs thinking, what the hell? This support's getting right up in my face. Of course, this bottom lane, talking about Forgiven, the AD carry. It's a champion, it's a player that obviously Reckless was talking about, saying he's a very similar style to me.
Yeah, and Forgiven was one of the members that helped Copenhagen Wolves qualify for the LCS. He destroyed Meteor Makers in games 2 and 3 of that series and just got better and better, actually playing Caitlyn as well, if memory serves correctly. Right now, though, that initial aggression that Forgiven Unlimited did a few moments ago actually has backfired. Niff and Tabs have been able to survive the HP thanks to the Relic Shield from Niff, the regen of the Vamp Scepter. Niff and Tabs now have a slightly stronger position.
Meanwhile, the top lane, we do see Youngbuck. He's actually farming between the lanes, and that may well cause him a problem because Shook is coming up between those towers. How's he going to get away?
Well, Youngbuck's going to be in trouble. Assault and Battery is available for Shook, and there he goes.
There he goes immediately. He does try and flash away. Actually flashed the moment it landed. That was very good, but it's not going to buy him enough time. The stun will come out from Wicked any second now. It doesn't matter. He's just going to use that. It's big calling and take him down.
Very well played. A little unfortunate for Shook not to chase through the wall. He did hit a tree and unfortunately couldn't go through it. But one thing I did notice, which was great as well, Froggen was already roaming as that gank started. So if Youngbuck had opted to go down, he would have run into Gragas. Right now, Amazing, he's jumped on Tabs, and Tabs takes a Lantern.
Not going to do a great deal about this. And Niff actually turns around and puts a couple of hits on Amazing. Of course, I did mean Kull the Meek, not the Culling, because, well, Kull the Meek does more damage than that ulti anyway.
I'm pretty sure Zenon will have a thing to say about that. Now we see Kautar being jumped on.
Explosive cast being thrown out. Kautar having to use the intervention. Is it going to be enough to roll away from this one? He has got the blue buff and his cooldowns helping out there. He will just walk away.
Yeah, with the blue buff and, you know, rank one intervention, it's about a minute and a half cooldown. It should be available again by time those next battles take place. And it's a good position for Kautar to be in because he's not losing CS right now. So as long as he doesn't get caught up by anybody else like Shook, he should be able to survive all of the bursts that Gragas is putting out.
A very even fight right now between all of the lanes. Of course, it's 2-1 in terms of Alliance. The death sentence being thrown out, not quite landing on Forgiven as he dashes back away from it. But it is Alliance starting to put pressure on this bottom lane. Despite the fight, they are slightly down in farm. Looking in the mid lane, though, we do see Shook. He's caught out Cocoon, not landing, but there's still damage coming out. And immediately, Frog gonna have to play defensive. Back down the bottom. Forgiven in trouble. Has to use that barrier. Is it going to be done? The death sentence landed. And again, the pills over Peacemaker. They've taken so, so low. The Ignite is going to take him down. But now Unlimited could be in trouble. Tabs is going to try and turn it around. He's got no mana available to use any skills. And now we see Amazing coming around the backside. He needs to go for the kill because he's going to die regardless. He's got no help coming in here. No mana to help him. Amazing's going to close this one out. Unlimited buying it, baiting him very beautifully.
Yeah, good play by Amazing. Managing to respond in time. We were talking about kills, and he has another one on Kaltard.
Kaltard in trouble. There's going to be Assault and Battery intervention used just at the right time, but I don't think he's going to have enough to escape this one. One more hit should do it. Froggen picks up the kill.
Lands the last tick of damage with the usage of that Ignite, and it's just non-stop action. Amazing forced to cover another lane. He's been roaming back and forth, and actually, Shook has been roaming significantly as well, making, you know, ganks and kills happen. With the fact that Alliance have the numbers advantage from those last two engages, they're going to start this dragon off, but Tabs is going to be a little bit late to this part.
However, looking at the top lane, you can see that neither of those are making any move. In fact, we see farming between the towers once again from Youngbook. Doesn't want a part of Wicked. Looking in here, Amazing's going to try and come in and get the steal. Instead, Explosive Cast forced him away. They still yet to get the dragon. Comes in, doesn't get the smite right. He gets taken down, and Amazing's going to have to flash away from that one.
Does manage to get away with his life, and I think Shook, very smart there, left the dragon at a higher amount of HP than a smite, and the HP damage from Elise was enough to kill it, and that just allowed him to land the combo immediately after. Right now, I thought Wicked was about to go in, and he actually is.
He is going straight for it. Is it going to be a burnout enough to keep him away? It is. Youngbug just walking away from this one. They're both very tanky in that top lane, but this is a heated exchange in all the lanes.
Yeah, it's non-stop combat by every single one of these players. The Copenhagen Wolves, I think, maybe even a little hungrier to try and pick up a victory here, knowing that their superstar jungler has gone to Alliance, and Amazing has done a very good job so far. He's ganked multiple lanes. He's put a lot of pressure on Alliance, and even though there's a 1,000 gold difference, that's only because of the dragon control that Alliance afforded themselves a little bit earlier.
So let's quickly take stock of what is happening. The two top laners, well, they've both got these Sunfire Capes. They're going to continue to bully him back and forth, but it is now level 9 for both of those, or well, it's about to be level 9 for Youngbook once he returns to lane. So we'll see how that power balance switches. The mid lanes, let's take a look at those. We can see, of course, it is going to be Kaltard trying to get out. Is he going to go for the Nash's Tooth? I'm not too sure which way he's going to go. But Athene's coming out for Froggen in the meantime, so he's trying to get the cooldown, trying to get the mana. Looking at the AD carries, Bloodthirsters all around. That's going to be what they're going for. And at the moment, we're seeing potential gank at the top lane, but I don't think Wicked's too worried about this.
Yeah, Wicked's going to release Ward out here. It does get caught by Amazing. I don't think they've got enough damage to take him down, but the one thing that is happening between Wicked and Youngbuck, they're basically ignoring each other right now. Youngbuck is playing very confident by farming between towers, but we'll see who has a bigger impact in these mid-game teamfights, and here's the Lantern Gank.
Lantern Gank, is it going to be enough? Assault and Battery on Unlimited. They hop, follows through. Death Sentence will be enough. Tries to use that Wild Growth, but he's not going to get him out of there. He will go down. They've got no support coming from any of the lanes. It's an easy kill. Explosive Cask in the mid lane. Kaltard going to get focused. Froggen realizes the jungler coming in, sidesteps the Cocoon, and backs away.
Very nice play there from Froggen to avoid the crowd control and style points for Tabs down bottom. They could have picked up the kill in Unlimited with a couple extra auto attacks, but he channels the ace in the hole. Now, red buff is being stolen away by Youngbuck with the help of Amazing, and they may have baited Wicked in.
Amazing using the smite, trying to get it away. Quick slice and dice through the pit, though, but I think it was Youngbuck that wanted that red buff. Bottom tower, though, going down. First one of the game. It's Alliance that get it.
So Alliance taking objective control here. They've got the first dragon, they've got the first tower, and when you've got a champion like Caitlyn, you can rotate her to the other lanes and start playing that very hard push strategy game. We'll see if Alliance decide to work that way, but I'm very happy to see Nif using the lantern to pull Shook's Vi in. It's a very powerful combo because you cannot get away from Assault and Battery, and she can engage from a much greater distance.
Kaltard in the mid lane just took another barrel that he didn't really want. As you can see, he's pretty much out of mana. He did just pick up that blue buff. Is going to stick around in this mid lane because he knows he has to defend the tower away from Froggen. Froggen, with that explosive cask available in a couple of seconds, could be dangerous situation for Kautar.
Now, this is the point that Copenhagen Wolves need to be careful. For Given and Limited, a little bit overextended, we're starting to hit the power spike where they could be in trouble. Flay did not connect. Froggen does have his cask available. He's going to throw it on Forgiven.
Oh, and Froggen missing out on that one. Forgiven flashing the second it comes in. Good escape from the Wolves.
Does burn the flash, though. So without a tower then, could get them in trouble. Wicked once again, 1v2, and once again looks like he might escape.
No, he's in trouble this time, has to use that Dominus. And this time around, I don't think he's going to be able to defend this turret against Amazing and Win Youngbuck.
No, not this time. And, you know, with the damage that Elise, her Spiderlings, and Shyvana deal, this will be the first tower of the game for the Copenhagen Wolves. And this is the period of the game where the Wolves need to get more objectives and make more plays like this. If Alliance can start roaming with this Vi, Renekton, Caitlyn combo, they can get kills, which can secure objectives, and that's how Alliance may want to win this game.
It's interesting to see how the jungle has been working, because Amazing effectively has been sitting on Youngbuck in that top lane, giving Wicked so many problems. Meanwhile, we've seen Shook, of course, down that bottom lane, so they're feeding each other, as it is Tabs, of course, coming out on top. 2-1-0. Meanwhile, it is going to be the ace in the hole, not doing a great deal. Froggen comes in, explosive cast back available in a moment. They're just trying to brute force their way towards this middle turret.
And this is the power that Alliance has right now. If you defend with too few members, the Assault and Battery into a Thresh Hook or even a Gragas Barrel is enough to scare you away. Youngbuck may get caught up. They're going in.
Assault Battery lands. They're going to throw their death sentence out. Intervention goes back out as well. Nif not managing to find the target, throws the box down, but nobody is in it. And that means Alliance are going to disengage and Copenhagen Wolves back away and lick their wounds.
Youngbuck able to get away with the usage of his flash there, so needs to be a little bit more cautious in these next few minutes. And I think I'm quite impressed by the response by Wolves. If Alliance had gone all in on the tower and targeted it, they would have been surrounded and engaged upon by Copenhagen Wolves. But Alliance backed away, and it does mean the Wolves hold on to that mid-outer turret, at least for the time being.
While this is all happening, of course, Wicked has been left alone in that top lane. Built himself up a 20 CS lead over Youngbuck. Youngbuck returning back to that lane. We'll see what Wicked goes back and buys. We'll see what comes out. It's a Hex Drinker in the top.
Yeah, that makes perfect sense. The amount of magic damage that is getting put down by Elise and by Kayle, you know, and the splash damage that Kayle puts out, I think it's a smart move, especially considering that Wicked is going to have to be the dive buddy. He's going to need to be able to survive along with Vi when they go under the turrets, when they try force the Copenhagen Wolves back line backwards, as it were. Dragon is respawning now. Alliance have position advantage. They also have strong vision control in this area. Top laners are responding, but a little bit late, and we'll have to see if Alliance can now reposition themselves to try and defend the turret as opposed to going for the Dragon.
Wicked didn't seem quite on the same page there. Amazing, was already coming down with Youngbuck. Meanwhile, he was there heading north. He was like, I want to go back and get this big juicy farm. But instead, now the Wolves have positional advantage.
Yeah, great play by the Wolves. They posture themselves towards the mid turret, saying, look, if you take Drake, we will go for the tower. They then have the positional advantage to force Dragon, and Kautar is caught.
Intervention used very early on here. Assault Battery followed through, seemed a little early. The explosive cast not doing a great deal of damage either. And now we can see Youngbuck, Wicked trying to get in. There's a lot of damage going back and forth. Tabs is just over the side, not really taking any damage. Now we see Unlimited coming around the side. That is going to be the first kill. Youngbuck's going to go down as well. Tabs in trouble. He gets dropped. Nif's going to go down. He gets popped as well. It's a 3-for-1 exchange for the Wolves.
Tabs flashed back in there just for a single kill, and Froggen's explosive cast did nothing. It didn't displace the Wolves. It didn't push them away. And that just allowed Copenhagen Wolves to barrel down on Alliance, stay together as a tight-knit group, pick up the kills, the Dragon, and most likely this tower, unless Wicked pulls a Superman defense, but I'm not expecting it.
A pressure start for Froggen and his boys, his team of superstars that he's put together. Would you believe it? It's his ultimate that actually misses and messes up the big key objectives. Dragon goes down, tower goes down, Wolves in control once again, and now they got themselves a 2,000 gold advantage.
And I really want to stress the fact that Kautar did great to flash out. Yes, he burned his intervention early, but he bought enough time for the rest of Wolves to wrap around him. We do see Shook catching Forgiven, but there was no Assault or Battery, no support, so couldn't go for the kill. In addition, Nif didn't have his box for the Dragon fight because it had been used earlier. They may want to dive on Kautar. They're going in.
They're brute forcing their way in towards this tower. They're going to go for Kautar intervention just at the right moment. Is it going to be enough to save the
day?
It is. And Youngbuck comes in and bullies them away, and they keep the turret for now.
Now it's going to be a three-man defense against all of Alliance, and here comes Froggen. He does have his explosive cask available, so more disruption, more ability to tower dive is available for them. This is going to be a 5v3. We do see Forgiven joining the party, but I think this tower's going down.
The Cullen comes out. It's enough to clear the wave just at the right moment. It keeps them at bay. Tabs caught out. Has to use the 90 caliber net to escape Youngbook. And, well, Alliance tried to brute force the way through, but it was not going to happen. The Wolves are not falling for it.
Alliance are playing the composition as we predicted. They have good siege potential. They have good dive potential. But the Copenhagen Wolves are using all of their abilities defensively. We've seen how the intervention saved Kautard, prevented that wave of taking the tower. Culling used to once again get rid of the minion wave, prevent a dive that Alliance weren't willing to do. And as long as the Wolves can keep up this defensive play and hold on to their gold lead, I can actually see their champions outscaling those of Alliance. So there's a lot of pressure on Alliance to find an opportunity right now.
And Kautar's not far away from that Lich Plane. He's already got the Nashes in there. Meanwhile, of course, it looks like the Rabadon's death cap's going to be built up by Froggen. But Kautar has been so aggressive. Like you say, in his defensive, those interventions have been on point so far from Kautar.
Yeah, definitely working out for him. He's 2-1-1, 156 CS, staying exactly even with Froggen. And Kautar's actually known for playing slightly different mid lane champions. He's still very famous for his mid lane Zyra, which he still plays even in this meta. And I'm very happy to see him playing Kale, and playing Kale well. Got an 800 gold lead over his opposite number, thanks of course to that dragon and the extra tower that they have picked up. And the question is now, how do the Copenhagen Wolves siege? They're slightly less effective, and they're more at risk of being caught. If they sit in front of, you know, a 5v5 under an Alliance tower, a hook, a barrel, an assault and battery could cost them. So Wolves need to ideally have a 5v4 or have a situation where they're uncontested at the tower.
Kautard coming around the back of Wicked. Wicked already just dodging, sidestepping away from that one. He's going to try and clear that wave in the top lane. Let's see what anything is going to develop here. Of course, the blue buffs were taken down a while ago, all on cooldown, so nobody going to be picking them up. Dragon is not available for a while. So we'll see where these teams go for an objective, where they try and brute force their way into any towers. We've seen Alliance trying to siege it down, not working out. Let's see if Copenhagen Wolves are going to try and react and do the same.
Yeah, I think for Alliance, because their last couple of pushes haven't necessarily worked out, they've needed to regroup. You can see everybody's now at full health. All of them have their abilities available, most of flashes, most of their ultimates. And now they're going to say, right, let's try the siege again. We do see Youngbug coming in from the river, though. And as soon as he's spotted by the Alliance wards, Alliance back away. They don't want to have that giant dragon jumping in there with the slow from Lulu's wild growth. So I think very wisely they decide to put some distance between themselves and the Wolves.
And every time Alliance group up like that, well, the Wolves are doing enough job to only have four members while they're clearing the jungle themselves. And Alliance are grouped up, so they're actually losing out on the experience, losing out on gold every time they try it.
Something that the Wolves are doing well is not only are they defending with, like you said, those three and the four members, every time Alliance group for a push, They get there just in time. They get there just in time to defend, just in time to have the right numbers. And it's something we've seen Gambit not doing in game one. You know, Gambit were unable to respond to the rotations and the moves by Fnatic. So Copenhagen Wolves have slowed this game down. You see, now they found themselves an opportunity where Wicked is alone. And it looks like Kautard and the rest of the team may want to go in. Alliance are now responding. They're the ones caught on the back foot. They're the ones caught a little slow.
Well, they may go and try and go for Lulu. Young Wicked's doing all he can to keep them at bay here while the rest of the team takes some time to get up there. Wicked's taking a good half its hit points. He's still got Dominus available if he needs to go for it, but they are bullying their tower down. And that is an inner turret going down for the Wolves.
Great play. Youngbug pressuring Wicked backwards. And very importantly, Kautard was there to zone Wicked away. Wicked couldn't get on those minions. The rest of the Wolves then back up. They get the tower, they steal all of the jungle camps, and they've got this massive ring of vision in Alliance's jungle that they need to respond to. Alliance need to pick up more sweeping lenses, and they need to get the vision control back on their side of the map.
Well, more of Malbordius has been picked up by Wicked. We'll see if that plays into the next fight, because the dragon will be up in 40 seconds time. It's Copenhagen Wolves already reacted. Everybody back, everybody buy. Get all the items you can, get straight back in there. Lich Bane picked up by Kautard. This could be a big power play by the Wolves in the next 30 seconds.
Yeah, that's for sure. You know, they need to make sure they have all items and they get as much strength as possible going into this battle. But I think they cannot underestimate the power of Froggen right now. He has his death cap completed. He also has his Athene's Unholy Grail. And we also see Tabs basically an item ahead. Got that static shift completed. whereas Forgiven is still working towards a Trinity 4. So I think the static shield damage, the mobility, the crit chance is a little bit more in favor of Tab's auto attack. So we'll see how this next dragon fight works out. The previous one, definitely a win for Copenhagen Wolves.
Yeah, cast your mind back to that fight. Of course, it was all about Froggen. That ultimate not finding its target. It's got to be on point this time around. That big Gragas ultimate is so big in this play.
Now, Alliance taking a small page out of the Copenhagen Wolves book. They're keeping two of their carries pushing the mid lane, forcing the Wolves to either react to the dragon or react to the tower. Now we've got both teams grouping up in the mid, and as we talked about, the initiation power is stronger with Alliance. Assault and Barry plus a hook is a better way of engaging, but Nif has missed his last few plays and his boxes haven't been great. It does look like we're going to have a straight 5v5. Dragon's down!
Dragon's down very quickly. The Cullen coming out, but not really landing any damage. Wicked's taking everything right now. We see Youngbuck doing exactly the same. He's trying to get in, but it's Wicked that's losing out. Has to flash away from there. Taken low. The barrel does blow the Wolves back. And now the Blue Wolves in trouble. The Intervention doing a great job of stopping the Ace in the hole. Wolves disengage. Alliance disengage. Nobody goes down. Dragon Wolves.
Nobody dies. Now the Wolves got Dragon. Wicked zoned so many people, and he took so much damage from the Wolves. It's allowed Alliance to secure the turret. There's nobody defending from the Wolves right now. They may be able to get some damage down, but I don't know if they can kill it.
They're going to go try for it, that's for sure. We can see Amazing coming in. They've taken half the hit points already. Amazing's got to be careful. They may go turn to this one for him. If the tower goes down, instead he goes aggressive. Have the rest of the team got back in time? They have. And you see Alliance going away. He's not done yet. He's going to go in for it. The Cocoon's going to get thrown out any second now. He can see Nif have to flash away. Cocoon lands. Is it going to be enough? The rest of his team come back around. Pops the flame back on towards him. Counter comes in. Secures the kill.
So one kill for the tower at the end of the day. Now all of a sudden Alliance are low. They were greedy. They stuck around for that second turret when they needed to back. They don't have the HP to defend this. And if they do, they may get caught out. Luckily, Froggen was smart enough to get away from that bottom lane, recalled, he's got max HP, and he should be able to defend this tower. He may need to use his cast. He does!
He uses the cast. Is it going to be enough? They go aggressive, they get the tower down, and now Alliance has to back away, and Copenhagen Wolves, they're 4-2 up in towers. They didn't even have Youngbuck in that fight.
80% of the viewers felt Alliance were going to win this game, and 80% of you guys must be screaming at home. Copenhagen Wolves are up in towers, are up in dragons, are up in kills, and are up 4,000 gold. They are responding to Alliance's pressure perfectly. They are defending their turrets for the most part well, and their team fights have been very, very good. But the one thing I really want to highlight, Froggen's explosive cast basically won Alliance the dragon fight. Yes, nobody died, but that fight, Froggen did a massive amount of damage, forced everybody from the Wolves away, and if that cast had knocked anybody towards them, they could have got a kill, and they probably could have got that second inner turret. So I think Alliance just need to slow down a tiny bit. They had a very good fight, very good win. And I do see Froggen playing very sneaky in this bottom lane right now. He doesn't have his ultimate yet, will be available. He may just pop Forgiven.
Shook is coming in with as well. We're gonna see Forgiven, he's in trouble. Assault Battery lands, there's the Assault Battery. Belly slam on towards him. He gets destroyed where he stands. Like you say, the sneaky plays, it's almost Fnatic-esque.
Yeah, too much heavy drinking and Forgiven just gets dropped under the turret, gets eaten by every single ability. And just like that, a kill goes to Froggen, a tower falls in the top lane, and a line showing they're in this game, but they can't afford to get too greedy. They can't afford to stick around when they should be smart enough to back away. Right now, full HP, four members of the team, they know Forgiven's not there to defend, so this is a good time to seize the tower.
Well, we see Wicked, he's going to be pushing in that mid lane. Remember, they took a lot of hit points off that inner turret in the mid lane, while the rest of the Alliance do put pressure on towards this bottom turret. I've got a feeling they may try and rotate around, but as it is, they're going to see if they can catch anyone down there. Shook is going to get caught out. Didn't take the lantern, strangely enough, there. And now that means he's in a little bit of danger, but there is the mid lane turret. That's what they were doing, keeping the pressure on the bottom. It bought time for Wicked just to take themselves a free turret in the middle.
Very, very smart play by Alliance, basically leaving Wicked on an island of his own, saying split push. You've got attack damage from the Maw of Marmortius. You've got the split power, the split push power from Sunfire Cape. And it's just allowing him to get all of those outer turrets and pulling the gold difference back to only 2,000 right now. The one thing that is going to be interesting to see is how Youngbuck Shyvana duels against, you know, Alliance's Wicked right now, because you've got super tank items being built up, but there's additional damage on Wicked Renekton.
So that's going to be the bottom turret going down for free, honestly. Youngbuck not being engaged on that one. It is now 5-4. Copenhagen Wolves in their first game in the Spring LCS. A brand new team coming into this one. This is not the same team that became Ninjas in Pyjamas, of course. Very different occasion for them. They're not going to want to start off 0-9 like the Wolves did last time, that's for sure. They're going to try and lock it out to Forgiven. Oh, that's a deep shot! Assault Battery. Quick Wild Growth had to be used to force him away. That's a big ultimate being wasted, though.
Very, very big ultimate is down. Not only that, they burned the ace in the hole. Luckily for the side of Alliance, those ultimates are not on the longest of cooldowns. From the time that engage happened, a quarter of the cooldown is already burned through. It's a minute and 20-odd seconds for Shook's Assault and Battery, so it will be up the next time they try Siege. But I think good defensive play by Forgiven. He wasn't as overextended as when he got caught out in the bottom lane, and he's going to need to make sure he plays a bit more safe in these next few minutes, because Alliance will just dive on him over and over and over.
Yeah, almost certainly going to be the target. We see again Froggen just looking towards it, see if he can find that barrel. Kaltard almost baiting it, wanting him to throw it. Got that intervention ready and waiting to counter it, as it is Alliance. Five members grouping in the mid.
Two things are in favor of Alliance right now. If you look at the top and the bottom wave right now, massive amount of minions pushing against the Copenhagen Wolves. So with a dragon coming up in about 40 seconds time, Alliance should be able to stall this one out and play the dragon dance. Try to hold the Wolves here as long as possible. Then if Alliance win the engage, they go to the wave that's closest to an objective, like a tower, and they can push it. Oh, so close to catching Kaltard. Nif missing a few skill shots this game, a little uncharacteristic.
Yeah, a little bit nervous possibly coming into this first game with a new team. Meanwhile, Alliance, they have positional advantage. 10 seconds before that, Dragon respawns. And honestly, this has been a dance that's been going on for around about a minute and a half already building up to this one. Not a lot of wards down yet, though.
It'll keep playing out in Alliance's favor if they can win the fight they precede. They are still 4,000 gold behind with Dragon respawning. Alliance have started off, and look how scared they're running. They don't want to get caught out. Did you see this is just a straight 5v5? Very good positioning here from Kaltard. He's going to push out the mid wave, but it does mean he's going to be a little bit late to this fight. If Alliance were to pull the trigger right then, they would have had an advantage. Right now, though, Copenhagen Wolves maybe instigating, implying they want to go mid lane.
Yeah, Kaltar's just going to go straight up. He's got an exposed inhibitor turret. He can get straight in there. Alliance having to respond to that. That means they're going to lose out. The Dragon could be the Copenhagen Wolves. Brilliant positional play by the Wolves.
Very good decision making here. They pull Alliance away just by their positioning on the map. Even if there was no win decision there for Alliance, there was nothing Alliance could have done with the exception of pulling the trigger on the team fight in the river. They waited a little bit long. Now all of a sudden, with the massive, massive minion waves in top and bottom, Alliance have the chance to do the same. The question is, where do they go? Because Forgiven's already dealt with one of those waves.
Yeah, he goes straight down there. We see him immediately in the top lane. Kaltard is back, and he wanted to get in and clear that wave. Realized the situation or problem. The Alliance are trying to bully their way down towards this bottom lane. Can they get themselves an inner turret? You see Youngbuck going full on aggression, trying to bully them away and doing a fantastic job about it. Once again, the Wolves defend.
They hold onto the tower, and I think very good wave control here from Alliance, realizing where they can push. Now, Alliance want to keep stalling the Wolves here. They've got that wave in the top lane that's now on the turret. It is dealing damage, and the longer Alliance can hold the Wolves here, the better the chances of roaming top and taking that tower later. Good poke down onto Forgiven already, but look for Assault and Battery, or most likely a good death sentence to be the go signal here for Alliance if they feel that somebody oversteps.
That top lane is slowly being dealt with, and that means Alliance are going to step away from this one, realizing the siege is no longer working. They're going to clear out that mid lane wards as they pass on through. Bloodbuff is available if Alliance want to try and sneak up there. They may be able to get there in time before the Wolves can respond, but not too sure they want to go for that. Instead, they're going to play it defensive, clear out their own jungle.
Well, the very first game of Alliance in the LCS, and they have fallen behind the Copenhagen Wolves. It is a line that I also did not necessarily expect to say at this point in time, but great, great play from Copenhagen Wolves. Their individual ability, as well as their decision-making, is just showing through right now. They've got a heap of experience, something, what do we say, over 140 recorded official matches in the Challenger circuit last year. And it's just teaching them, showing them what to do at this level. Alliance now need to channel a little bit of evil geniuses, slow the game down, get another 10 minutes on the board, and then try to counterplay when that 6,000 gold difference is not as impactful.
And you can see where the gold difference is. Just look across the board. It's 1,000 gold almost every single lane. Supports, it's almost a 2,000 gold advantage for him. It's only the AD carries that are actually held equal, and that's because Tabs, of course, picked up those three kills. But overall, Copenhagen Wolves are looking strong, and it's a 1,000-goal advantage for Kautide over Froggen. That's something I didn't expect to say, especially 32 minutes into this game.
I would dare say that in this game, Alliance have been better at team fighting. I think if we compare all of the fights overall, with the exception of one dragon fight, I think Alliance have done a better job of engaging and disengaging. However, Copenhagen Wolves have been in the right place at the right time for objectives. They've been able to defend their towers more often than Alliance. They've been able to respond by taking towers of their own when Alliance wasn't ready. But we have still been seeing the fact that Copenhagen Wolves cannot siege. So Copenhagen Wolves do not want to be in a situation where they're facing 5v5 at a tower unless they have an immense gold lead because of the power that Alliance has. And I think this 7,000 gold lead may be enough for them to try. But again, a good barrel from Froggen, that could single-handedly win a team fight.
Well, the Wolves are looking hungry right now, and they're moving in towards the Alliance jungle, coming around, and they're going to try and tank up this bottom turret. Alliance are nowhere near, but Alliance are thinking, do we run down the bottom? No, we don't. We've got to react to this one. And with a Kale and a Lucian in there, that tower is going down in seconds. There's nothing they can do about it.
Yeah, I rest my case. Copenhagen Wolves, they psych out Alliance. They make him think a 5v5 is going to happen in this mid lane. They make him think this is what the Wolves want, when immediately the Wolves just roam down bottom, take the last remaining outer turret, and it's only inhibitor towers. Smart play from Wolves once again. Mostly are recalling, but they should be able to get in range to defend their inhibitor turret. And I think if Alliance were smart, they would have rushed bottom. I think they should have committed to a tower. They haven't, and now they're going to get surrounded.
They second-guessed one another, and they were split there. That's decision-making not quite working out. Instead, they're going to go for Youngbook. Now they want to lock in. Assault Battery does find Kautard. Intervention views, though, and they could turn this on his head. Wicked tries to go in. Popside Dominus, you can see, is not going to be a great deal of damage from the Cullin. Now Niff's going to get caught out. Niff has to flash away. Tabs is in trouble. He's being chased by the jungler and AD carry. Meanwhile, down the bottom here, Shook and Wicked. Wicked's going to go down. Now Shook's in trouble. He's going to have to try and dash through. He will get away. Froggen and Tabs are with him. And another great reaction play from the Wolves.
Almost could have gone worse there. Alliance managing to get away. Tabs put a good Caitlyn snap trap down that actually held Forgiven in place. And when Amazing dove Tabs, Amazing went, oh, whoa, whoa, we got way too much damage for me to deal with. Amazing was forced away. What it does allow Copenhagen Wolves now, knowing Wicked's not there and knowing a lot of Alliance's ultimates were burned, specifically the stealing potential of Froggen's Gragas, they've started Baron. This is still risky. Alliance are moving in as a three-man from the river. Kautar's taking a lot of damage.
The cask will be up in time if they need it. You can see it's almost off cooldown now. They're going to go in towards it. There goes Shook comes in, but that's going to be picked up. Unlimited goes down now. Shook's going to get taken down. It's a one-for-one trade. They're going to try and back away from this one. No, another one goes down because Tabs went to pick down Lulu. Unlimited in all trouble. Meanwhile, Tabs, he's got a big, scary dragon all over him in the form of Youngbug. He's got his support player trying to help him out as much as he can. Flays it up there. Tabs is life stealing all the back. Is it going to be enough? Tries to get another shot. No, it's not. Youngbug gets in there. They bully him out with the regen of Baron.
Copenhagen Wolves now 10,000 gold in the lead. Win another team fight. Youngbug didn't even use his dragon's descent. He flashed onto Tabs to chase him down in human form, had the ability to chase further, was anticipating a defensive 90 caliber and wanted to then chase dragon, didn't even need it. The Wolves once again peeling away from the dragon at the right time, coming out in an advantageous position with those kills. And I think Alliance right now, if they don't pull off a heroic defense, they are going 0-1 in their very first game of the LCS.
Well, we could also talk about the scary potential that is a Kale. And of course, a Kale, once they start getting those big items, which he's already got, you see the Rabadons, you see the Lichmen, you see the Nashes. We've already seen in the promotion series how scary that can be with Overpower. Kautard is heading that way.
Tabs has no defensive items. He has no additional MR outside of his Runes of Masteries and what he's getting from his teammates. And if Kautard gets on him with a full combo, that is going to be a dead Caitlyn. It's something we've seen over and over, and we've hit the point, 37, 38 minutes now, where Shyvana is super scary. Youngbug is now 1v3, takes a little bit of poke, and generally he's going to regen this thanks to having that formula, the Spirit Visage, and all of the stats from Baron Nashor. Copenhagen Wolves can now siege 5v5, thanks to the very big lead they've accredited themselves.
Youngbug is an absolute monster on Shyvana now right now. There's nothing. You saw Wicked going in there, and he just took a third of his health from actually hitting Youngbug. He just did nothing back to him. Meanwhile, it looks like they're going to be able to siege this one down. Oh, the hook! That's going to be intervention quickly used. Assault Battery wasted. Explosive cast does manage to find his target, but Forgiven. He's managed to tank through. He's tanking the turret. The turret will take him down, but that's going to be Copenhagen Wolves reacting. Shook in trouble. He's going to get singled out here. Dashes away towards the top turret, but it's going to be the Wolves that take down the inhibitor turret.
That was a big mistake for Forgiven. He should never have been caught there. But even with that mistake, Copenhagen Wolves are so far in the lead that they lose their AD carry. They put the Wild Growth, the intervention. It took so much time for Alliance to kill him that the rest of the Wolves managed to shut down Tabs. They get the turret. They didn't get the inhibitor, though, which is a small win for Alliance. But overall, Copenhagen Wolves just in a commanding position, and they can just rinse and repeat. Set that up again, force everybody from Alliance backwards, take the inhibitor, back away.
Ladies and gentlemen, it seems we have a competitor, and it is going to be the Copenhagen Wolves. And, you know, a lot of these top teams, and I'm talking, looking at Cyanide's AMA, you know, the fact that they're all talking about how Alliance have the potential to beat the top team, the new super team coming into this one, but the Copenhagen Wolves do not write them off because they have a 12,000 gold lead in their very first game in the spring LCS.
And it does look like Alliance, even though it's a new roster, they took the EG spot, we're still running to the late game for their matches. Long, long game so far, 40 minutes on the clock, and I think Alliance, their backs are completely against the walls. And unless Copenhagen Wolves make a mistake, unless Copenhagen Wolves overcommit, basically like Forgiven being caught out there, I don't see a way that Alliance can break this matchup. They're too far behind to go for a straight 5v5. I don't think they're strong enough to actually win. So once again, the onus is going to be on Froggen's explosive pass, splitting up the Wolves, singling out a target, and then fighting the rest of the fight favorably 5v4.
Well, it is the Wolves once again pushing into Alliance's jungle. Alliance are simply playing defensive duties now, trying to keep those inhibitors intact while the Wolves, they gather to go up the top.
One of the things I also think the Wolves should have been doing a little bit earlier, and maybe we'll see them doing in the next couple of minutes, we're still sitting on 4 war trinkets and 1 sweeping lens. If I were the Wolves right now, you should have 2 or 3 sweeping lenses, clear out the vision from Alliance, and force Alliance to face check, especially as Baron should be coming up in the next couple of minutes. Right now, you see Baron buff has actually worn off all of the Wolves, so this is going to be a straight 5v5. Once again, we're looking for the barrel from Froggen. I think that's the safest way to initiate. Barrel into a hook. The rest of Copenhagen Wolves are on the inhib turret.
Well, the Cullen trimming off hit points off Wicked there, realizing that everybody nipped down to half health as well. Everybody's slowly being poked down here, and the poke from Wolves is not what I was expecting to be talking about. I was talking about Froggen with those barrels. But they are slowly losing hit points on this top and inhibitor turret.
Yeah, down to half. There are super minions on the Nexus turret. If Tabs were to defend the Nexus turret, they would lose the top turret. So we have to keep an eye on how much HP gets down. The rest of the Wolves. Oh, Cal got caught.
Gets caught out. He's going to get amazing dropped in there. But look at Wicked. Wicked, the tankiest member of the team, getting bullied down. Youngbuck just getting straight in amongst them. And they are forcing through. This is going to be the Copenhagen Wolves. They're taking down amazing Alliance in their first game. Absolutely brilliant play. The Wolves clean house there. They pick up 2 kills. They take themselves another inhibitor turret. They take themselves a Nexus turret. They're going to finish the game.
Copenhagen Wolves going huge in their very first game of the LCS, taking down Alliance in what I would say is convincing, and they've done it.
The Copenhagen Wolves win game 1 of the LCS. What an impressive performance. They were up against the Super Team Alliance, and they get themselves a convincing victory. They countered them every step of the way. They defended when they needed to, and they turned on the aggression when it counted. Brilliant performance by Copenhagen Wolves.
Kautard has secured his first win of the LCS. He has played in the mid lane. He has played as an AD carry in the spring split last year. And in his inaugural match, goes massive on Kale. Only dying one time against Alliance, 4-1-5. But what a great performance from that whole team.
And we talked about the junglers, Shook being poached, going to Alliance. But look at amazing, 4-0-9 at the end of that game. An amazing performance.
Is the only way to say it. He played brilliantly. I think the most impressive thing from this game right now is their reaction to how Alliance was pushing them. Alliance was roaming around the map. You know, we talked about how the 12 to 25 minute mark was where Alliance is going to come into this power spike, where they can tower dive and get away with a lot of things. Look at those stern faces. That is not the same team we've seen against Dignitas.
Absolutely not. The Copenhagen Wolves coming across, you know, handshakes coming out from Alliance. But, you know, honestly, coming into this one, anything but a 2-0 on day one for Alliance, I think, was going to be a serious, serious doubt. And that is going to put serious questions in their mind because, well, they're playing Fnatic in 2 games' time.
It raises questions. What went wrong? And I think not only did Alliance necessarily not pull off their tower pushes in the mid-game effectively, I would dare say Copenhagen Wolves just responded well. I think Copenhagen Wolves, they had, like we said, just enough members, just in time to hold off the turrets. The defensive ultimates of Wild Growth and Intervention were too much. That once Alliance had pulled the trigger, there were no more bullets to follow up. There was nothing else to follow the Assault and Battery in the barrel. And that's what allowed Copenhagen Wolves to survive the mid-game and push us to that late.
And, you know, there's a lot of things we can talk about throughout on the top lanes. We talked about the fact that Wicked went with Renekton over Shyvana. It was a questionable choice. You know, it goes either way. It depends on the play. He kind of got camped a little bit by Amazing. But that first dragon fight, that was kind of the opener. When that barrel landed on the Intervention, did no damage at all. The rest of the team, then they just clumped up and destroyed Alliance.
Yeah, definitely. The very, very first dragon fight where Copenhagen Wolves lost one, they got the dragon and picked up 3 kills, as, you know, on the way out, I think was it stemmed how every other fight went. And I don't want to, you know, hate on a particular player, but I felt that Niff did not have the impact that we've seen him had in the past. A number of plays in the very early game, up till the first 20 minutes, where the hook, yeah, okay, sometimes it doesn't land, but the Flay's got a much wider missile, you know, width. He didn't pull targets back. Alliance jumped on people that they couldn't kill, and they just committed too much, and it backfired for them.
And where do the Wolves find these players? Because Amazing and Forgiven, both coming into this one, playing brilliantly.
Forgiven ends up 1-3-9, and I think he was playing from behind for most of that match. What he did do, with the exception of getting caught once, is not be at threat of being jumped on by Vi or by Renekton. The whole time up to that like 40-minute mark, he was never, ever, ever the person in the middle of the fight. He didn't flash in for that last auto attack. He wasn't caught out. And even though it was really Youngbuck and Kautar that I think led the way to the victory, because they were such big threats, it bought Forgiven the time to deal damage from the back line. So I think very good positional play and decision-making from him not to go deeper when you're behind.
Well, it is time for us to take a break, but when we come back, Shox and Joe will be joined by Youngbuck from the Copenhagen Wolves. It's taken him many times to get here. That first victory is going to taste very good for him, I'm sure. Then, of course, Rockout, they're going to be taking on the team.